Doctor Who, Death to the Daleks, by Terrance Dix. Read by John Culshaw. Prologue. He was a dead man running. He ran blindly, desperately through the swirling green fog. Deep sobbing breaths rasping into his tortured lungs. He knew there was little hope. Somehow, he had been separated from the others in the ambush. And now, his enemies were hunting him. Without checking his run, he glanced back over his shoulder. Shadowy figures were flitting through the dunes behind him. His foot slipped on a loose rock, and he pitched forward onto his face. He rolled over, scrambled to his feet, and ran on, snatching another quick look behind him. This time he saw nothing, but he knew that they were all around him, herding him across the dunes like a hunted beast. As he ran, confused memories flashed through his mind. Selection for this all-important mission? Farewells to family and friends on Earth. The landing on this isolated hell planet. And then, disaster. A superbly equipped expedition from one of the most advanced cultures in the galaxy, suddenly and utterly helpless. He reached a small, stagnant pool, stopped to get his bearings, and a black, cloaked, hooded figure rose up before him like a ghost. He turned aside, and another appeared, barring his path. He swung round. More silent figures had appeared behind him. He snatched the blaster from his belt and glared defiantly around him. The weapon was useless on this planet, but if one of them came close enough, he could use it as a club. There was a sudden blur of movement from one of the silent figures, and he felt a blow over the heart. It felt no worse than a heavy punch. But when he looked down, there was an arrow jutting from his chest. More arrows thudded into his body, and he staggered back, falling with a splash into the little pool. As its darkness swallowed him, his last bitter thought was that he had failed. His entire mission had failed. And because of that failure, untold millions would die a hideous death. Chapter 1. Death of a TARDIS. The police box, which was not a police box at all, sped through that mysterious void where space and time are one. Inside the impossibly large control room, a tall, white-haired man with a deeply lined, young, old face was making a few final adjustments to the instruments. Despite the ultra-modern nature of his surroundings, he was dressed with old-fashioned elegance in narrow trousers, velvet smoking jacket, and ruffled shirt. A door opened, and an attractive dark-haired girl appeared. She wore an abbreviated beach robe over a 20th-century bathing costume and carried a big, striped beach bag. "It's all in here, Doctor. Sunglasses, sun lotion, water wings." The doctor smiled. "You won't need water wings, Sarah."
"Oh, yes, I will. You said we were going swimming."
"You can't sink on Florana."
"I can sink anywhere," said Sarah pessimistically. "I need a life jacket in my bath."
"The water on Florana is effervescent. The bubbles support you."
"Sounds like swimming in a glass of health salts."
The doctor was in great good humour. "All right, Sarah, all right. Just wait till you've seen Florana. It's the most beautiful holiday planet in the galaxy."
Sarah felt contrite. It seemed unfair to be so suspicious when the doctor was in such a holiday mood. But somehow, she just couldn't help wondering if the doctor's lavish promises about their destination were really going to be fulfilled.
During her relatively brief acquaintance with the doctor, the TARDIS had taken her to a particularly violent era of England's medieval past, and to a London mysteriously infested with dinosaurs. The doctor had assured her that this time, everything would be different. To make up for these terrifying experiences, he was taking her to the most beautiful, the most peaceful planet in the galaxy. She noticed that a red light was flashing on the TARDIS control console. Other lights began to flicker, and needles on the instrument dials were oscillating wildly.
She looked at the doctor, but he was staring blissfully into space, still summoning up the beauties of Florana.
I always come away from those long golden beaches feeling 100 years younger.
Doctor?
And the beauty of Florana is that unlike your own little planet, it hasn't yet been spoiled by...
Doctor, should that red light be flashing like that? And all those others?
The doctor swung round and saw alarm signals registering all over the TARDIS console. He dashed frantically around the console, adjusting controls. A fuse blew with a crackle of sparks and a puff of smoke. The lights in the control room went dim.
Sarah was frankly terrified. What is it, Doctor? What's happening?
Well, it seems to be a major power failure. Hang on, I'll just cut in the emergency circuits.
The doctor pulled a lever, and all at once, everything returned to normal. The main lights came up again. The warning lights went out.
Well, that's a relief, said the doctor. If the emergency units hadn't worked, we'd have been in real trouble.
The main lights began to fade, and the emergency signals on the console started flickering once more.
It's happening again, said Sarah. Do something, doctor.
The doctor was leaning over the controls, frowning in concentration. For the TARDIS to fail in this way meant only one thing. Some outside force was operating against it. A sudden, fierce jolt made him clutch the console for support and sent Sarah staggering.
What's happened, Doctor?
I can tell you one thing, Sarah. We've landed.
He pointed to the center column, which rose and fell steadily while the TARDIS was in flight. It was motionless. One by one, the warning lights on the TARDIS console started to go out, and the indicator needles on the dials crept back towards zero. The main lights grew dimmer and dimmer, and there was an uncanny silence.
It's as if the TARDIS is dying, whispered Sarah.
I better try the scanner, while there's still enough power to operate it,
said the doctor. He threw the switch, and the scanner screen lit up. The picture was dim and fuzzy, and all it showed them was sand dunes and swirling green fog. Slowly the picture faded, and the scanner screen went black.
Fascinating, murmured the doctor.
What's so fascinating about fog?
Perhaps that fog is what's putting the TARDIS out of action.
The concealed lights in the TARDIS ceiling began going out one by one. Section after section of the TARDIS was plunged into darkness. Finally, one central light source was left, bathing the console, the doctor, and Sarah in a little circle of light. Then it too began to fade.
Don't you have any other emergency power source?
Asked Sarah.
Yes, of course. I'll switch over to the backup system.
He threw a switch, and the lights came up again. Sarah smiled with relief, but not for long. Slowly, the lights began to fade.
Dud battery?
Suggested Sarah nervously.
Hardly. Listen.
I can't hear anything.
Exactly. Neither can I. Nothing at all. Not a click or a tick. Nothing. The TARDIS is a living thing. Hundreds of complex instruments, working all the time. Its energy sources are perpetual. Never stop.
Well, they have now. Everything's completely dead.
It's just as you said. The TARDIS is dying.
The doctor looked around the control room. It was almost completely dark now. Just the faintest of glimmers from the central light.
Sarah, look in that locker over there. I think there should be a torch on the upper shelf.
Sarah opened the locker and groped inside. She took out an enormous torch, the heavy industrial kind, covered in black rubber. She switched it on, and a beam of bright light illuminated the console. Sarah felt better immediately, until the beam of the torch began slowly fading. In a matter of seconds, it had died completely, and the darkness returned. The doctor was hunting inside another locker. He emerged, carrying a large, old-fashioned lamp, the sort coal miners used to have. Sarah managed to smile. Don't tell
me. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.